Please note that though this is a spoiler-free review of the subject, I do spoil the series and/or franchise leading up to this particular entry. Put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. X2, X-Men United, movie review. When a mutant attempts to assassinate the president, military defense contractor William Stryker is granted authority to go in and detain some of the mutants residing in Xavier's school. And this does, in fact, involve a few dozen soldiers and at least a dozen mutants as well. There are various reasons why the team kind of splits apart. Basically, it really all has to do with trying to find, you know, figure out what happened, what the assassination attempt. You know, who did it, why, and yeah. And this splitting up does mean that, you know, we get to explore the characters separately and their relationships, and it also makes it more tense whenever one of these groups encounters Stryker's forces, for example, and they don't have the support of the full team to. And thus also we again have the splitting up of the powerful mutants, so that, yeah. And Magneto also escapes from jail, and much like in the comic, he works with the X-Men in order to, yeah, and before the authorization of the strike, Senator Kelly, meaning Mystique, posing as Senator Kelly, is actually right there in the Oval Office with Stryker and the President, and, you know, says this is just a school, you know, regardless of anything that the Brotherhood did in the first movie, they don't want an actual attack on, you know, these children who happen to be mutants. This is based on the comics God Loves, Man Kills and Weapon X. And God Loves, Man Kills was apparently one of Singer's favorites, presumably of the ones he was recommended, since he wasn't actually a comic book reader before directing the first movie. You know, before enough people basically convinced him, try to actually, you know, read some of them, watch some of the animated series. And where in the first one we have a mutant villain, here we have a human one, which, you know, it's so in part mixing it up, and also, you know, you could say that Senator Kelly was a minor villain in the first one, but he wasn't directly trying to hurt people. Not from his perspective anyway. He didn't think that anybody would be hurt. He wasn't talking, let's punish them. He was talking, let's segregate them. Stryker, he definitely, you know, just the way that the attack on the mansion plays out, he's not that bothered by the idea of killing some of these mutants if they pose a threat to his forces trying to, and he kidnaps a lot of these children. So, yeah. And that is, of course, one of the really big themes of the X-Men universe is regular human beings who try to hurt the mutants. And the, you know, I read both of those comics in preparation for this. Actually, in God Loves, Man Kills, Magneto rips part of a train off, somewhat similar to, yeah, what he did in the first movie. And the, you know, some ask, why is it called X-Men United? You know, my friend Kierman had poses, they were never ununited to begin with, which, that is true, but ununited is completely redundant. The word is ited. The basic idea probably is that people who just watched the first movie and don't know anything about the comics may have thought that X-Men were mutants, not the team of X-Men that fight for, you know, peaceful coexistence, but just mutants in general. And, you know, okay, so that, I guess, works for that, but to everybody who knows, it just sounds kind of weird. And the, in a lot of ways, this is better, or at least as good as the first one. There are some ways that it is lesser, but to be fair, we do already have the first one. They don't have to match all the strengths, and this has some different strengths. Also, you know, if you watch this movie and you feel like the first one simply was the better movie, you can just, you know, basically, you know, as most of us do with the Terminator franchise, just say only, you know, the ones I don't like don't exist, and just watch the ones you do like. The, you know, this has much bigger scope. The threat is greater. It has more sets and locations, more mutant powers used, more characters, more just people. The action is bigger, better, and there's a lot more of it. Apparently in the first movie they have about 520 visual effects shots, and in this one they had 800. And the movie isn't that much longer than the first one, so yeah. And we delve deeper into some things that were introduced in the first one. We see a lot more of what the jet can do and what it contains and such, and we get more, we get a greater appreciation of what Cerebro is and what it can do. And basically, with the success of the first movie, it was clear to the studio, who decide how much money gets put into these movies, that yes, people do want this kind of movie. So yeah, they granted them a lot more money, and basically everyone working on this movie were like, okay, let's try to do everything we did in the first one, just bigger and better. And thankfully, it fares a lot better than the Matrix sequels in that. And yeah, some of these things, they do an amazing job of, you know, improving upon. The movie is 2 hours and 8 minutes with credits and 2 hours straight without them. More or less in response to the success of the first movie and such elements of it as Mystique and the incredible powers of Magneto and Storm. You know, basically this, you know, they went, okay, so you want blue people, cool, fantastical mutant powers and dangerous attacks on armed government, you know, like cops and such. Okay, how about three-fingered, prehensile, detailed Nightcrawler teleport attacking, meaning punching, kicking, flipping over with his tail, his way through the Secret Service into the Oval Office, just short of actually murdering the president. You know, where the first one has just one blue person, this has two, and the third would have had three. And it's a really good escalation of the conflict, although for some reason, rather than him just straight up teleporting his way right from the start, at first he's kind of like pretending to be part of a tour of the White House, and he's got is whiteface a thing? Basically, his skin appears to be white for that first part, and they just never explain it, and there's nothing that, and he never does it again since, when he actually talks about, it clearly bothers him that people look at his blue form and are bothered by it. So, yeah, they should have just had him teleporting. Anyway, Nightcrawler is also in the comic. However, there he wasn't a new, you know, he didn't just join the X-Men there. He had been a member for a while. And the comic actually also has something fairly similar to in the first movie, where Wolverine puts his claws to the neck of a guard and, you know, just barely stopped short, letting the middle claw go straight through his neck. And where the first just introduces the jet, it's basically there. It's what gets them from point A to point B. And there's, what about Harbor Patrol radar? If they have anything that can pick us up, they deserve to catch us. Okay, so it's got tech. They don't really have to put, they don't put the jet through the ringer. There's not a lot it has to be able to do that they needed to. In this, however, we do see it put in a bit of a dangerous situation, and yeah, we get to see what it can do in those kind of circumstances. Now, there is a lot of kind of romance type stuff in this, and almost all of it has some problems. Some of these are major problems, and I'm gonna go into it when I talk about the separate characters rather than just going through, them one by one right now, since they are specific to the specific characters. And I do want to make it clear, I am not against like romance stuff in fiction overall. I absolutely love the love relationships in End of Watch, Season 4 of Dexter, and I suppose I shouldn't give away any names, but yeah, the major romances of Deep Space Nine. And another thing is there are very few new mutants. We just spend more time with the mutants we already met in the first one, and the new powers are sometimes just variations on ones we already know. Like, you know, ones that are decidedly not are, for example, Nightcrawler's teleportation. But, yeah, other than that, largely, yeah. The X-Kids do sometimes provide exceptions to that rule, but those just aren't as cool and as like decidedly either defensive or offensive as the adult ones. the movie does reestablish some of the powers and relationships for people who may have forgotten the first movie. You know, there are 3 years between the two being released, or for people who just didn't watch the first one for whatever reason. You know, you can go into this completely blind. You know, don't get me wrong, it's nowhere near Avengers 2 Age of Ultron levels of that, but still. And Bryan Singer and, I want to say his name's Tom DeSanto, say that this is essentially the Empire Strikes Back of the series. The good guys are split up, and dissected. There are important revelations, there's romance, and really big, impactful things happen. Which I suppose might make The Last Stand Return of the Jedi. No, Return of the Jedi is still better than The Last Stand. At least by some. When Wolverine, he's introduced to someone as he's one of the teachers at Xavier's school, and they ask, what are you a teacher of? Art. And I like to imagine that that's because he rearranges people's faces. He again has a big climactic fight against another mutant that he has some history with and somewhat equal powers to. However, in this, they are not really set up as nemeses. The way they very much were in the first one. In the first one, Wolverine fights just a few humans, and and also some mutants. In this, he takes out upwards of a dozen of the of Stryker soldiers within just a few minutes. We get to see his berserker rage, which was hinted at in the first one but never seen. And he will learn some about his mysterious past, more than just these PTSD-y flashbacks that we've seen him get. Although, if you go into this really expecting a lot, like, there's not an awful lot of detail to it. And at one point, he and a few of the students are in Iceman's family's house, and I think he almost killed their cat. Where in the first one we meet Rogue's family, in this we meet Iceman's family, and there's, I'll get into that later. And it's not the same scene, but we do have the parents realizing that, that their offspring has some special property. Which of some monetary value, property taxes notwithstanding. And in this, Rogue does genuinely wear the gloves from right away. She puts on gloves for the first time relatively early in the first one. In this, she just always wears. Yeah. And this is where I get into some of the romance stuff. In the first one, her touch puts you in a coma or almost kills you. In this, she kisses Iceman, I counted, 9 seconds, which I'm almost certain is longer than any touch that You know, except for the one at the very end of the first one. You know, when Wolverine transfers his healing powers to her to save her, that might have been more than 9 seconds. But other than that, I'm almost certain that no touch in the first one is anywhere near that long. And in this, it barely has any effect. Like, she borrows the ice thing for, you know, at least a few seconds. Then she, you know, breathes out, and it's basically like, you know, cold wind, kind of. Yeah. And it's not as though she's, if she were maybe being extremely careful, if she were holding back or something, okay, maybe. But that's not it at all. It's quite the opposite. She's decidedly, you know, completely releasing her inhibitions and just really getting into this kiss. And yeah, it's lazy writing, and unfortunately it's not the only lazy writing. They wrote it that way because they wanted that to happen, not because it made any sense. It makes it seem as though her powers really aren't that big of a deal, when in the first one it was a huge part of her character. It was such a, and since her character is, you know, the audience, one of the two audience proxies, and the most relatable one, yeah, it's a huge mistake for them to make. But and it's not even that it's really the only time where her powers don't seem to have much of an effect, because when Wolverine first returns to the mansion, the two hug, and they very carefully angled it so that, you know, basically her long hair is what touches his face, so their faces don't directly touch, and she's wearing the gloves, so yeah, their skin, yeah, Rogue's skin does not touch Wolverine's skin at any point. And there are times where she, yeah, where, I suppose I shouldn't give away, but yeah, other times her powers do actually have an effect. Iceman, in the first movie, he turned a fist-sized fireball in, you know, he froze a fist-sized fireball. In this, he creates, like, this big ice wall of, you know, they talk about, like, it's 2 or 3 tons heavy. It's like 10 centimeters thick. It's at least a meter tall, maybe more. A few meters wide. It blocks a hallway, and yeah, and where Pyro in the first movie just creates this, you know, or forms, he can't create the fire, he can only manipulate it. In the first one, he just, yeah, shapes this fist-sized fireball. In this one, he full-on, he's throwing fireballs, he is, like, blowing up cars, in the first one, it was Magneto who dominated, like, over a dozen cops by using their own, you know, yeah, by attacking their equipment, you might say. In this, it's Pyro who does that by blowing up cop cars and throwing fireballs at police and such. He's basically a young face to Magneto's ideals, and it's very clear he had a bad childhood, and that's why he is somewhat aggressive and, yeah. where the first one had a somewhat softer seeming and more, I guess I shouldn't say GQ because the new one isn't entirely, but yeah, actor, this recast him, and they I want to say it was called Tadpole or something, where he apparently also played someone a little bit dangerous and such. You buy that this is someone who would be throwing fireballs. You know, it's one thing to be able to throw fireballs. It's another to do it, especially against cops. And Jean is starting to experience that her powers are getting out of control and really expanding, and it's been getting worse since the Liberty Island incident. Storm gives a, she has a lot, it's a much better performance this time, in part because there's now less to no accent, and her hair is, excuse me, also at least slightly better, not, excuse me, as silly. I realize that the character does have long, flowing white hair in the comics, but it is, you know, I mean, they ditched the colorful costumes. They should probably have done something with the hair as well. And she's given more screen time because Halle Berry won an Oscar. In the first one, you know, she uses lightning a few times and she creates a storm to cover for the jet. In this, she creates, I think it's like 9 tornadoes to fight against US fighter jets. And they actually, the special effects people talk about how there are more tornadoes in this one sequence than in the entire movie Twister. Nightcrawler is introduced doing something awful, but we find out that there's more to it. And this does mean that we have a creature mutant, so it's no longer the attractive good mutants against the ugly evil mutants. His basic background is he grew up in Germany and became a circus acrobat because of his teleportation powers, and he has this very graceful movement, so you buy that he, you know, performed in the circus. Again, it's one thing to be able to teleport, it's another to have performed in a circus. You need to, yeah. And the, you know, this opening is very carefully choreographed by both him and the filmmakers and set to passionate classical music. I don't know the artist, but I feel like I know Nightcrawler enough to say that he likes Mozart. They do an excellent job on what's called the bamfing. The, you know, when he teleports, the sound as it's written out in the comics is always bamf. And yeah, you know, you have to make a, the, of course, there were some, you know, he was in some of the animated stuff before this, but they can't necessarily just directly take stuff from there. You know, it has to work, and they did a great job on finding the right sound. And they do actually have, when he teleports, a little bit of smoke will come out, because he basically, it's like fire and brimstone. He teleports down there and then back. I want to say that's how it is in at least some of the comics. It's been a while since I read his stuff, but it's somewhere, it's something along those lines. And, you know, in the comics, he wields a sword in each hand. Not all the time, but yeah. And so here they give him a single dagger, which he uses once, which he kept in his boot as he teleported and fought his way into the Oval Office, and somehow it stayed put. It doesn't look like he had a proper, like, sheath down there that was then stuck to his boot. It's pretty incredible that the blade stayed down there, but nevertheless. Like I said, he has three fingers on these, you know, claws or, you know, paws, more or less. And he has three-toed hooves, and he is, you know, completely blue. It's the basic, you know, with hooves and a tail and such. He has some resemblance to a demon as interpreted by Christianity, which apparently at least one early version of him basically was a demon. So yeah. And he is a very devout Catholic in this, where, you know, in the comics, there's one point where he became a priest for a while. I guess I should address some people apparently hate, you know, not just the religious aspect of the character, but just the character in general. They think he's underused, which I disagree with. He's used just right. Every character is underused in these movies. You know, you gotta take what you can get. And he has some of the best scenes, and his character really shines through. He, you know, Alan Cumming actually does speak German, so that was part of why he was chosen. And they, you know, some people think that his German accent, when, you know, there are several times where he genuinely speaks German, and of course, fluently. But they also give him this accent for the rest of the, you know, I guess it's, they're trying out, seeing if, okay, Kenyan accent doesn't work, let's try German. I think it's fine. I mean, he's German. He hasn't spent that much time in, you know, English-speaking countries, and so he speaks with a thick accent. It's, yeah, I don't know. Doesn't bother me. And some people hate that he is as religious as he is. I don't see a problem with it. It's not like he's not going around trying to convert people. He expresses his views, but he's not saying, "And because I have God on my side, I am right." Yeah, he's very religious. Some people are. You know, I get I'm supposed to have a big problem with this because of my, you know, but yeah, I don't have a problem with it. Yeah, it's there's and the movie isn't trying to tell you that he is right for being a Catholic either. The movie doesn't take a stance either way. It's just one of his qualities. You might as well say, but he has a tail. It's just one of his qualities. You're not asked to love it or hate it. And he is a very, you know, he's very caring and very sweet character. Alan Cumming did not return for the third movie, largely due to the makeup, and it's really too bad because he is perfectly cast. His performance and characterization are just spot on, but they probably should have gone with a model the way that Rebecca Romijn Stamos was. You know, she even says on the DVD for the X-Men 1.5, if you don't have modeling experience, you can't stand to sit, you know, to sit still and have makeup applied to your whole body for that long. And she's right, you know, and she, She has a smaller role in the third one, but she still did have to sit through a lot of, like, you know, yeah, less screen time, but whenever she's on screen, she's still blue from top to bottom, completely naked. So, yeah, she put up with this process, let's say, 2.5 movies. And Alan Cumming, in spite of not being in that much of this movie, didn't come back for, you know, I'm not going to say even a second time. He didn't come back for a second time. I completely understand. I would never be able to sit still like that. You know, it's just, that's kind of the way it has to be for a character like that. But it's, you know, we are not made to be, to have to sit still. Now I'm sounding religious. We did not evolve to be comfortable with sitting still like that and having people constantly, you know, apply. Yeah, getting all up in your personal space. Yeah. And the, you know, at his core, Nightcrawler represents the hope for peaceful coexistence, because he looks about as foreign, you know, as inhuman, as it were, as these movies get close to making us believe actually exist. You know, in the comics there are ones that are even, you know, less humanoid and such. You know, when you break it down, he is a human who's blue, who has hooves and paws, and has a tail. There are ones that are much more far out in the comics, but yeah. And, you know, in spite of how much he's been feared his whole life because of the way he looks, he has chosen, you know, to smile and laugh and to be affable, to embrace other people rather than respond with the fear that they've shown to him. And he's even briefly contrasted with Storm, who, though she fights for humans and for peaceful coexistence, is, you know, bitter. She has, you know, yeah, she has also had a lot of bad experiences, and her ethics still place her on the side of the good guys, but yeah. And the, you know, the two become friends, and Mystique is also contrasted with Nightcrawler, and, you know, she has gone as far as to hate and attack humans eagerly, you know. And yeah, you know, the two blue people who've both, you know, had a lot of attention about them and who have been feared by everyone for most of the lot. You know, Mystique can take on another appearance, but then she's not being herself. You know, that's not her, you know, getting by, that's her running away from reality. And she says as much, basically, you know, very briefly and in just a few words, but that's, you know, that's basically how she sees it. And this again uses her, you know, shape-shifting powers really well. The, you know, because there are, she's in more different situations in this one than in the first one, you know, they get to use it even better. There's literally one point where she sneaks into a place by making herself appear to be basically the person in charge of that place, and walks in, and as that person says, "We have a shapeshifter, she can look like anyone." And then as one of the people, you know, she walks into one room where there's one person sitting there and she has another person right behind her. And just as she, you know, just as the person sitting in the room goes, anyone, you know, like, you know, just briefly comprehending that, we see behind him that she knocks out the guy with her and then knocks out the guy in the room and then shifts into Mystique. You know, not immediately after, but not many seconds after. And it's just, yeah, it's such a nice little, you know, she's legitimately using her, the threat that she might come by soon to get it. You know, if she just burst in and didn't say anything, they'd be like, what's going on here? But no, she's, this is serious. There's a shapeshifter here, and yeah. And she, you know, she fights again and in her own form. You know, where in the first one, she basically fights one strong mutant for a little bit. In this, she fights, like, upwards of a dozen, you know, humans who all have guns and training, and she just wipes the floor with them. And she also, you know, in the first one, she helps Magneto on his various missions. In this, she helps him escape jail, and it's this really, yeah, it's an amazing scene. And we also get to see more of the technology surrounding the plastic prison and more plastic objects to, you know, to be safely used in, you know, in the plastic prison. You know, she gets to do more, she has more lines, and she has probably the worst of the romances. It ends up with her not having sex with Wolverine. But there are a series of problems. I suppose I should briefly, I could maybe understand the two falling for each other. Although it doesn't really seem like he's particularly interested, but you know, they both have this kind of, I am a wounded animal kind of, you know, the way they approach the rest of the world, basically. They're both incredibly skilled fighters, and they are quite comfortable with killing their enemies. And, you know, for the, you know, and he did manage to sniff her out, as it were, and he was the only one who, you know, in the whole first movie, nobody sees through any of Mystique's disguises as having shifted into someone else, other than Wolverine, who does it twice. And, you know, he might also have some, you know, have some respect for her, you know, in spite of his, you know, how formidable he is, she still kicked his ass. He got his ass kicked by Mystique and Sabretooth. Magneto, Rogue. There are times where Wolverine does not come off quite as badass as he is. But then one of the first things that happened in the cartoon was also him getting, yeah, it hurt his pride more than anything, but he did get knocked across a room by a mutant, not necessarily the strongest, but yeah. The problem with the romance is she does not approach him as Mystique. She approaches him as Jean Grey. This is less than a minute after he has, after she, you know, yeah, I'll quote the exact exchange between Nightcrawler and her. Nightcrawler approaches her and says, "They say you can imitate everyone, anyone, even their voice." And then she imitates his voice and evens their voice. And he says, "Why not look like them all the time? So, you know, so you wouldn't have to hide." And she says, "Because we shouldn't have to." And then she goes in and, yeah. I realize that it's not the same thing. That her, you know, coming on to Logan isn't the same thing as always posing as a non-mutant. I'm willing to grant that maybe she knows that he'll be able to tell. At first, he does realize it, but at first he doesn't realize it by, like, smell or such, but he's, you know, it's clear that he is basically overwhelmed by the, you know, he's not alert, he's not thinking something dangerous might happen, he's thinking, oh, maybe I will get to have her. He realizes by finding her scars that he gave her in the first one, which is a decent little, it's basically the only limitation we ever see to her power in, you know, she can look like anyone regardless of their, you know, size or shape or whatever, and sound just like them, and yeah, but a scar is still a scar. She can't hide that. That, I do think, is a decent, you know, interesting little limitation there. Maybe she knows that he'll be able to tell. Maybe this is like flirting to her. That helps things, but it doesn't fix everything. Basically, if he didn't know, then he would think that he had sex with Jean Grey, which would mess up the love triangle even worse than, yeah, and, you know, if, and they actually, they talk about this on the commentary track, and then, you know, one of the other characters would spot her leaving as Jean. Yeah, I think the real Jean would spot Mystique leaving as Jean, and she would realize that Wolverine, yeah. If he does know that, you know, if he had, you know, if he knows that it's not really Jean and he still has sex with her, that means he doesn't actually want Jean. He wants to have sex with someone who at least looks like her. This is equivalent to, and they do actually mention this in the commentary, that it's equivalent to hiring a prostitute and, you know, basically telling her your name is Jean Grey. You know, I don't have any problem with prostitution as a, you know, the way I see it, prostitution should be legal and protected. And I have talked at length about this in other videos, but just, I don't have a problem with prostitutes, and I don't really have a problem with, if, all I'm saying is, if you do have sex with someone pretending they're someone else, I think you owe it to the person you're having sex with to tell them that you're pretending they're someone else. And it just, it means that you're not actually interested in the person that you're pretending they are, because if you were, you wouldn't, yeah, you know, if you want to be with someone that you can't be with, then you, and, you know, simply, you know, whatever the exact reason is, then you accept that if you actually love them. If you just want to have sex with someone who looks like them, then maybe you will, you know. Yeah. And if Mystique didn't necessarily care if he found out or not, if she managed to trick him into having sex with her, that's rape. You know, if she's pretending to be someone else, you know, just to have sex with, you know, someone who she does genuinely appear to care about. She, you know, once Wolverine rejects her, she accepts that, but she did genuinely seem to want, yeah, you know, that's equivalent to, you know, putting a bag over her head or something. It also kind of means that Mystique must not think very much of, you know, Wolverine's relationship with Jean, that, you know, that he would just, you know, do this, you know, have sex with someone who looked like her. And then she morphs into the, or shifts into the other, you know, the, yeah, basically, you know, I was going to say the other X-Men, but I guess Rogue technically is a student, not an X-Men. But, yeah, she morphs into Storm and Rogue, which kind of suggests that she's, I suppose, thinks that Wolverine, if he could have sex with either of them, that he would. You know, never mind the fact that Rogue, in both of these movies, is very clearly into Bobby, you know, Iceman, and that Storm barely at all gets along with him. They have a very hostile relationship. The you know, yeah, in these two movies, they just barely, like, they bark very insulting things at each other. But yeah, apparently, you know, Mystique figures, hey, if, you know, it's got a pulse. You know, let's be honest. The idea here was for the teenagers in the audience of both genders, and any sexual orientation could be, well, actually, I suppose, yeah, scratch that, because, yeah, well, I suppose if they don't mind that, it would still be straight sex, but, yeah, that they can, you know, sit and enjoy that, oh, hey, that, you know, each of those actresses got to lie on top of Hugh Jackman, and Hugh Jackman got to have each of those actresses lie on top of him. We, in William Stryker, you know, I mentioned already that he is a human and not a mutant. He's also very human. He's, you know, you understand where he's coming from. He's not this muhahaha, you know, tie a woman to railroad tracks. There's a very clear, he really believes what he's doing, and he thinks that it is the right thing to do, basically. And yeah, those are the most compelling villains. The Brian Cox, who plays him, has played a few other employers of assassins with PTSD. You know, this is not a spoiler. There's very clearly some kind of, you know, clearly Logan at one point worked for Stryker. So, yeah. And, yeah, Brian Cox has played other employers of assassins who have amnesia as a result of some kind of traumatic event. Jason Bourne and The Long Kiss Goodnight, which if you are not seeing, you need to. Samuel Jackson is great in it. Her name escapes me at the moment, but she's also in The Fly. She's the major female character in The Fly, and one second. Gina Davis is incredibly sexy and cool in it, and the villain is this over the top. It's Craig Bierko, the protagonist from The 13th Floor, and he's just, it's amazing. His performance is so much fun. But yeah, in, you know, he's a military scientist and defense contractor, and in the comic he has been in the army but isn't anymore, and he's more based on Jerry Falwell. Basically, when it was written, and should make clear, you know, it's not the Jerry Falwell, it's not his religiosity. Yeah, I'll get to exactly what the author of, you know, since I just read God Loves, Man Kills, it was, you know, a reprint, and he wrote, you know, like, he consulted his Bible many times as he wrote it. He himself is a Christian. You know, God Loves, Man Kills, that's not supposed to be, like, ironic or something. No, he's saying, you know, the Falwells of the world are wrong, God loves. But yeah, the you know, when the story was written, the you know, Jerry Falwell and others, their exclusionary language was just short of, you know, actually encouraging attacks on the, you know, the people that they blame for the evil in the world. The, you know, in both versions, you have the, you know, this very publicly support, this very public support of the hatred that, you know, while not always equally strong, is always in the films. You know, it's not in all of the comics that mutants are feared and such. And, you know, today televangelists are not so much, you know, uncomfortable, bordering on scary, you know, anymore. However, some, you know, a group of people that are defense contractors, you know, okay, they, you know, they attack terrorists, but terrorists, a notoriously loosely defined term. If you, in the U.S., if the government says this individual is a terrorist, then suddenly that individual loses a lot of rights. It's not, you know, you don't have to be convicted to be labeled a terrorist by the government. And the you know, if, basically, the if the idea here is that since one of these mutants is a terrorist, then how can we, you know, maybe all mutants are at least, you know, this is a minority who we aren't quite sure if we should trust. We, you know, clearly some of them are capable of violence. You know, the Nightcrawler's attack on the president isn't the first time mutants have done something violent. That was, you know, the first really public example was at the end of the first movie, where, you know, not everybody knows what happened there, but everybody saw, you know, the whole world was watching clearly some kind of, you know, field of energy approached the, you know, the world leaders and then stopped. And, you know, something happened, and the people that, you know, we the viewer don't know how much the you know, just civilians know about what happened there, but, you know, the authorities, they know that a lot of people of, you know, the harbor patrolmen and various guards and, yeah, died there. And, you know, they, at the end of that, Magneto ended up imprisoned, so the authorities know that he did something that he needed to be in prison for. So, yeah, you know, it's just the with the attack on the president, it becomes even more immediate. You know, it was like, okay, well, there was that one, but we put him in prison, so he can't do anymore. But then here's another mutant who does something, so maybe we need to investigate this minority that we have an uneasy relationship with, who aren't integrated. And yeah, the movie is a stunningly well-written, you know, allegory. It's very much saying, you know, not all Muslims are terrorists. You know, there are quite a few of them who just want to live their lives in peace. And yeah, it's impeccably written, you know. But yeah, so okay, these Muslim mutants, maybe more of them are terrorists, so let's detain children. And you know, the fact that the initial actions of Stryker and his men are sanctioned also mean that the X-Men can't, you know, call the government for help. You know, if, you know, in the first one, they're going up against Magneto. He dominates a SWAT team, you know, almost just for the fun of it. You know, he's toying with them. He's, if, you know, if he wanted to just move on, he could just, you know, just slap him aside and, you know, go somewhere else and then wait for the helicopter to arrive. No, he wants to stand there and have some fun with them, threatening them with their own weapons and, you know, making Oreos out of cop cars. It's a very, you know, what good are, you know, a SWAT team, for example, going to be against Magneto there in the climax? You know, if the X-Men called and said, you know, that guy who attacked the SWAT team outside the train station, we know where he is, you can come here and you know, help take him down, you know, yeah, what good would it do? But in this, it, you know, yeah, the reason they don't call in this, even if they thought that they would be able to convince them to send help, well, I mean, the first few steps at least were completely sanctioned by the president. So yeah, and there is also an explanation for it in the comic. And yeah, I think, you know, what it, the one in the comic works well there, but I do think that it's good that they changed, that it's different here. Cyclops, The visor is a lot better. It's a lot more subtle. It's something you could wear in public without attracting a lot of unwanted attention, say, a train station. They're basically just a snazzy pair of shades now, which, that is, a character literally says, cool shades or something like that. So, yeah. I realize that Cyclops in the comics have worn both both the visor he does in this and the visor he did in one, but these movies are set in a very in a world very close to our own, which is also it does also bear noting that in at the very start in the comics, Cyclops' visor was very close to what it is in this movie. And he does get a little bit more to do in action. He gets to fight hand to hand briefly, but it's very short. And just, yeah, it's the idea is that it's supposed to show, well, this is why he can't just be, James Morrison points out in the on the DVD, otherwise Cyclops could just be huge because all he ever does is raise his hand to his temple to fire the blasts. But it doesn't really prove that he's all that good because it's very short and he loses big time. In general, he's not in a lot of the film. And woefully, this has way less of, Xavier and Magneto's, for one thing, them communicating directly with one another, and for another, them talking about their ideologies. Like, Magneto gets just a few. And it's not nothing. There's still a little, but and Xavier gets a little bit, but in the first movie, three times over the course of it, do they directly meet and communicate and talk about their opposing views on, mutant human relations. And in this, basically, I suppose I shouldn't give away exactly, but it's less. And Magneto again gets to easily take out a dozen armed men by using their own weapons against them. And we spend several minutes in one of in inside Xavier's head in a hallucination. And the film very skillfully goes back and forth between the hallucination and the real world. We're never confused and it never looks silly. That's the kind of thing that, whenever sci-fi has to represent, okay, this is a simulation or a hallucination or something, you always have to be very careful that it doesn't get to be silly. It very easily can be, and a lot, early like virtual reality stuff in films, a lot of that was really silly. There are some portions of the simulation that the hallucination that are cut and can be found on the DVD, and I think if they had kept those in, that might have made it more confusing. So I'd say they made the right choice there. And this also has Colossus, who's this big guy, but very sweet and, not, somewhat quiet. He doesn't say an awful lot or such. And he can His whole body can become covered in steel. And there's this one point where he's attacked, and, you know, basically, like people are shooting at him, and, like, the bullets are, of course, you know, basically just bouncing off, you know, easily. It doesn't, you know, hurt him in the least. And then the camera cuts to right outside the room that he and the other person is in, and then you see the guy fly out through the wall. And this was a thing that they would reference in a few other movies, maybe especially comic book movies. I had a list of it once, but the only one I'm certain of today is that it's also in The Punisher, when the Russian throws Frank through a wall. And speaking of Russian, in the comics, Colossus is Russian, and I forget, I'm not sure they say his full name in these movies. I don't think they say his last name. You know, basically, they call him Peter, which is the Western version. You know, technically his name is Pyotr, and his last name is Rasputin. So, yeah, if they said his whole name, it'd be like, I don't think he's from around here. I think he's Russian. And, yeah, they do sometimes call him Peter, you know, outside of these films as well, since, yeah, that is legitimately the you know, anglicized version, I want to say it's called, of the Russian name. But he does not speak with an accent at all, and that was probably because they wanted to avoid the Halle Berry's, another situation like Halle Berry's accent in the first one. He is one of the characters who does get at least a little screwed over by a exposition-y line. Another is Scott, unfortunately. Right after the attack on the, you know, as soon as the X-Men, you know, get a chance to talk about the assassination attempt, Scott says, "I think this is Magneto." And immediately, I want to say it's Xavier who immediately says, "I don't think so, because this would just hurt his, you know, he wants the, you know, he would know that this would not improve the status of mutants in the world." And it's like, of course they do. Magneto would not do anything like this. It's entirely unlike him. And the line is basically, they needed someone to say, to comment on, yeah, they needed the setup. This is not Magneto, because he knows that it would make things worse. And I don't see why they couldn't just have had Scott say, "This doesn't sound like Magneto." And then Xavier could say, "You're right, because..." Instead, yeah. And Colossus gets the second one, which is when the mansion is under attack. Wolverine is walking towards where Stryker's men are coming from, while Colossus is, you know, around some of the X-Kids. And Colossus says to Wolverine, "I can help you." And Wolverine says, motioning to the children, "Help them." And it's like, oh, right. Wolverine can handle himself. Meanwhile, I've got prepubescent children who have no idea what's going on, who are just woken in the middle of the night by men with guns. Maybe I should help them out. And it's just, it's because the filmmakers needed to communicate, why doesn't Colossus go with Wolverine? And again, Colossus could just have said, "I'll get them to safety," instead of, yeah. And Yes. Yeah, and that covers it. Yuriko was originally Anne Reynolds, and in both cases, the character is William Stryker's personal secretary. The reason it's not Anne Reynolds is that they wanted a mutant who could be in a great hand-to-hand fight at the end of, in the climax of the movie. And I say, I tell you this because it's very clear that that's what's going to happen. They talk about that they wanted to make this character like, what, why is she here? Where is, and then, oh, she's here to fight. The thing is, very, very early on, she gets a very, very brief fight scene, and it's a pretty decent fight scene, but it's way too short. And it's, yeah, the rest of the movie, you're just sitting there waiting for her to get to do something. You know, we don't know the extent of it. It's only a small taste of what she can do, but you know, obviously she's going to, she's still there for the rest of the movie, so obviously she's going to get to do more, and then only there at the climax does she get to where every other mutant who has, you know, who has screen time over the course of the film gets to use their powers before the climax. It's not just, and not such short, you know, unsatisfying ones as hers. They really, I feel they should have completely changed how they approached her character, but I'll get more into that in the spoilers. Kitty Pryde is again in this one. The second time they cast someone for her. It still, it didn't take, but next time it would. And that's good because eventually Ellen Page does get to play that role again. So, yeah. her poor character really just does not get... Yeah. In the first one, she just briefly, you know, phases through. She runs through a closed door. In this one, she runs through a couple of walls, and that was originally all she was going to do. But first, she's one of the ex-kids attacked. Before she starts running through walls, she phases through her bed and the floor, and then lands, you know, the floor right, you know, yeah, she drops one floor down, basically, and this is something she can very comfortably do in the comics, and it's just, it's such a good little, because it makes sense, you know, basically, she, and you see her start to focus before she phases through the bed, and then, you know, yeah, it's like a light switch. She can turn on and off her power, and when it's on, she, you know, it's gravity. She's falling down, basically. And then she turns it back off before she hits the floor, and yeah, it's a really great little moment. The costumes are as good or better. On Rotten Tomatoes, the summary basically says that it's, you know, tightly scripted, well acted, and ambitious, and it, you know, it's the right way to do a sequel, and that sums it up quite well. One critic on there said, and I do think this is worth addressing, though he is very clearly completely wrong. He said that the plotting is dangerously self-interested, and there's, you know, kind of a bullying tone. Because the movie is primarily about, the threat is mutant, you know, yeah, mutants are threatened. They're on, like, yeah, their survival. The first movie is primarily, the real threat is to humans. The, yeah, you know, you have these mutants who are in part killing some humans, but who intend to, you know, their plan is to make mutants out of the world leaders, but we find out that it's actually going to kill, and Magneto doesn't take that seriously. So if the climax of the first movie, if they hadn't managed to stop the machine, then a ton of human beings would have died. And so in this one, you know, the major threat is towards mutants. That's, you already know that this series and these characters care about the survival and well-being of humans. So now it's just saying, okay, but, you know, also mutants, which is, again, you know, the first establishes that these are the good guys. You can trust these mutants. They're very different from you, but don't worry, they do want to keep you safe, and they do need to, because there are other mutants who are, you know, who are willing to kill human beings. And then this one says, well, let's go in and see, you know, and like I said, mutants in this are a lot like the way Muslims were viewed, to some extent are still viewed, you know, since 9/11. And, you know, it's, but yeah, especially immediately after, you know, since the first movie came out before 9/11, and this one, you know, this is from 2003. This one says, maybe you shouldn't be so worried about this one minority, because it could actually lead to basically, yeah, you know, hurting, at the very least hurting an awful lot of this minority who, though you don't belong to it, are still human beings. So, yeah. And, you know, one reviewer points out that the mutants are very vanilla. They're kind of bland and goody-goody, and that is true. I'm not sure we're going to get a movie that's very different from that in this franchise, but I would like to see, you know, down the line. Heroes did have some. But, yeah. And I'm just going to quote this review. The, you know, great parallels to 9/11, John Ashcroft, the Patriot Act, and the other racial thuggery of, you know, the Bush administration. And that it, you know, it's stirring activist peace. And one pointed out that the ex-kids being, you know, dragged from their houses like the INS. It's been a while since I heard it, so I'm going to try to pronounce it correctly. Elian Gonzalez. Yeah. And that singer updates the, you know, takes the civil rights subtext and updates it to a post 9/11 perspective, and that, yeah, that really is incredible work on that. And the movie has a mostly great coming out scene where it works. The character is basically saying, I actually am a mutant. And, you know, the idea here is, you know, yeah, it's, you know, maybe most obviously about homosexuality, but in the first movie, most of the stuff could very easily be applied to, you know, in the first video I listed all the different groups that it could apply to. And in this, you know, the scene is pretty good for a while, but then a character says, have you tried not being a mutant? And it's like, that works for your sexual preference, excuse me, and your gender identity, as in, you know, have you tried not expressing who you are? I'm not saying that's okay to suggest to anyone. Obviously, it is not. But, you know, someone who's ignorant might say, well, can't you just do that? But it doesn't work for the rest of the minority. You can't change you can't change your ethnicity. These mutants have powers, and some of these powers are automatic. You know, the character is basically saying, stop having mutant powers. It makes no sense. And no, I don't think that works as, oh, well, this person just hasn't really thought it through. The person is otherwise clearly supposed to be smart, and if that's... When you're trying to argue a point in a movie, you should give the opposition the best... You should let them make the best argument they have, so that when you counter it, you're like, see, this is where their best argument fails. If you have the opposition just using a terrible argument, then it just, you know, for one thing, that's really easy and kind of boring to even argue against, and for another, it just makes it seem like, you know, the reason we explore the arguments of our opposition is to try to understand issues better. You don't understand issues better by just, yeah, not at all putting in effort there, but yeah. You know, again, a line that's far better is, you know, why not look like them all the time? Because we shouldn't have to. And this movie definitely has too little mutant, you know, good guy mutants fighting evil mutants. And they actually do have a reason, you know, they have a... Yes, the bad guys is a human being who, you know, who has an army of human beings with weapons, but they could still very easily... There is an actual explanation in the movie for how could there be evil mutants, and they even do have a few, but just not very many. The action is better and more varied than in first. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.